problems of government policies in view of our position as the OECD and EU member country. Second, the exchange of experience, international comparisons, raise of awareness to the problems of government policies, especially related to the Czech Republic. And the third, the creation of platforms for regular experts meetings with government officials, policymakers, on issues of government policies, especially in the area of labor market and employment policies. Sincerely, Minister of Finance, Andrej Babiš. So there was just a, just a short note from the minister, and without any further ado, I would like to turn the floor to the second panelist and to Jan Švejnar, who's chairing the panel. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much, Przemysl. The great benefit of being a person who is being celebrated, which I greatly appreciate, is that you don't have to give your own presentation. You get to just chair and listen, so I'm really enjoying it. This panel, as you know, is about policy making or applications of economic research into policy. One thing that's important in this area is that you be quick on the draw and can quickly go into action, and so we have reacted to the fact that we had to reconstitute the panel a little bit, and we have two panelists who were not advertised before, Daniel Munich and Hartmut Lehmann, both of them excellent researchers. Daniel Munich is instrumental in heading, in fact, the policy-oriented studies here and at CERGE-EI within the think tank idea that we started 7 years ago. Hartmut Lehmann leads the transition part of ISA, of the Institute for Study of Labor, and has organized numerous conferences, himself has carried pioneering research that's policy-oriented, and so I'm really pleased that both of them agreed to join us. We will start from your left hand. We'll start with Klaus Zimmerman, who already was introduced, the head of ISA in Bonn, with his presentation of how ISA has been doing policy-oriented, evidence-based policy-type research. We are pleased to have with us Minister of Labor, Michaela Marksová, who has worked in this area for a very long time, both within the Parliament and the Social Democratic Party. Now as the Minister of Labor, she has interacted with CERGE-EI for many years, so it's a perfect person, that's the perfect person here to give us a sense to what extent evidence-based policies are or are not used in this country as yet. Stefano Scarpetta, who heads the Employment Department, one of the most senior OECD economists who really has been charting the research and policy work of OECD for a number of years. Daniel Munich, as I mentioned, senior researcher here at CERGE-EI in charge of labor and policy studies in general. And Hartmut Lehmann, as I mentioned, professor of economics at the University of Bologna and the head of ISA's transition program. So without much ado, Klaus, can I ask you to start?
Thank you very much, Jan. It's my pleasure to be here again and also to open this last panel. We met, I guess, well, in the early 90s for the first time. Well, actually, we met at CEPR when Gerard Roland, you and myself were program directors for a number of years. So we were kind of colleagues. And okay, from that time is the connection, but also my understanding that transition economics is a very important aspect in economics. It played a big role, and that's why also we created, when ISA was starting a few years later, also a program to, in particular, studying transition issues. Now, this area at that time had a big challenge when you look at it from the evidence-based policymaking position. Because, well, I mean, there was a big challenge from the policy side, what should we do? But there was no evidence, yes, because there could be no evidence. So, because this was new. So the routine that you have particular wonderful solutions you can apply were not there. So there was, this was a time of experimentation. Now, evidence-based policymaking in general has a long tradition. It's hundreds of years old. Many continents or many countries, people fight for it. Policy is not always doing it, sometimes doing it, and sometimes forgetting about it, and sometimes coming back. Now, first, what are the elements? Well, it's about that, well, facts are relevant for policy making. That's something we is most politics does not follow facts. Yes, so the idea that you should not ignore facts is a very important observation. Second, one has to understand what's going on in the real world. One has to be able to interpret the facts. You need theories. And also, you have to be able to work out options. So the scientist who is preparing academic or scientific evidence-based policymaking is not a person who is an agenda-setting person who wants a particular result. He is a person who wants to provide reasonable information and alternative reactions policymakers can take up. That's, I think, the core, as I see, from the strategy of evidence-based policymaking. Now, the problem is that scientists, like many of us here, are thinking long-term challenges, yes? And if they have a problem, they say, okay, come back in a year. Then I give you perhaps an answer. I have to first collect data or whatever. We don't have information or we need future work. That's a typical situation. However, policymakers as such, yes, every day there's another challenge where they need an urgent answer and have to act. So it's very natural that we as scientists have answers to questions policymakers are not asking, and policymakers would love to ask us issues where we have no clue, no answer, where we have to experiment. So the real problem is that in very fields we have no real hard evidence, but that is certainly what we should use and do. Now, what the ICAE project World of Labor is, and you can go to one of these rooms here next, you see some examples, pieces, we are in the process of create 500 policy pieces of 10 pages each, where we try to condense evidence and provide potentially alternative lessons for policymakers on important issues. And many of these issues deal also with transition economies. So there are two ways to do evidence-based policymaking. It's ex ante. We can say if things are over, then we can have a serious evaluation of what a policy measure has done to the labor market, to in the context of transition countries and so on. Now, there's also the possibility that we have to have make recommendations in an earlier stage. Then it's very important that we impose on the policy making the requirement that there is a kind of a way to evaluate what has been done. So program evaluation is a very important aspect labor economists bring into this game. And the success of the German labor market reforms has also to do with the fact that we nowadays very seriously evaluate labor policy programs. So in a way, there are these two forms. And that's why evidence-based policy making can learn in general very much from transition economics, because we have had the problem before, and we have now lots of experiments which we can summarize. Now, give me a bit, listen to me a little bit on issues now which have to do with concrete examples where I think where evidence-based policymaking is really important. We all have seen EU enlargement, yes? And one of the big challenge of EU enlargement was how does it affect the labor market, the labor economies. And there were lots of fears before beforehand. Millions of people flooding us in the core original EU, yes, and taking jobs away, depressing wages, taking welfare up, and so on. The German Bild-Zeitung, yes, said 40 millions would come. Now, the evidence, I mean, the predictions were modest, a few millions perhaps, yes, over a long period and so on. De facto, it was a bit, yes, it was more than perhaps here and there expected, but it was a bit. But the evidence we have nowadays, and lots of ICA research has gone in that direction, is that it was very beneficial there where we had let the labor market work, yes. Not in Germany, we kept our borders closed, not good for us until the last moment, better for the UK and Ireland, Sweden was not affected. We have no evidence that this was bad for the EU in general. There was no welfare take-up, there was positive effects on the labor markets. This is proven in many studies. Now, later on, we had these waves of debates, welfare take-up when Romania and Bulgaria came in, was a recent debate, they all take welfare. The evidence was that most of these people were working. Practically nobody was taking welfare, at least less than other migrants and maybe even less than natives in Germany and so on. So it was nevertheless a public, and that's a very interesting and challenging issue. If it now comes to refugees, we have the same debate, yes. There it's a little bit more complex, but it's the same debate. The evidence is completely different when academics look at it and speak to the public, and when the public looks at it through the media and sometimes through the policy debate, where people say, oh, I don't know about it, but my voters have a different feeling. They're anxious, and okay, then the job of the policymaker is to take the facts and be in an open debate about it with people. Now, that's where scientists have a chance to go in, and that's why I think we repeatedly now, for the maybe since 10 years, we do this game. Every second year again, we have the same kind of debate, where the evidence is completely different from what policymakers or the policy debate is going. So with the refugees, yes, we know I'm coming from Germany, yes, and we are expecting 1 million refugees this year. Maybe they're already there. Oh yeah, they're flooding us, they're taking the jobs away, and they cost a lot, and so on. If you look at numbers, and the OECD has said that, the EU Commission has said, my government has said, we scientists say, these are small numbers, these are big numbers, yes, and they come in fast, but economically, these are small numbers. They may, if there's unemployment, then it's only people from for refugees, but in a few years, maybe the unemployment rate is rising for half of a percentage point in Germany, yes? Or similar calculations. So the numbers, the actual numbers, look large. They're also large in comparison to what typically comes to the United States, yes? So it's a big burden in terms of administration, about of managing, but it is far from the reality, the economic reality at least, is far from what the public debate is. Now the question is why, and this is maybe a question I ask myself all the time when I'm in these debates. The next one I will have on Monday in Brussels on the same topic in a public debate. It will be interesting to see that discussion. And it would be interesting to whenever I'm in these discussions, I'm interested to learn what can we do to bring public reception and facts better in coordination. Maybe with this kind of intervention, I stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Klaus. Thank you very much. This was very nice, informative as a start. We now will have some report on evidence from a particular country, namely the Czech Republic. It really is a pleasure to have the Minister of Labor here, who, as I mentioned, has actually worked on this issue long, even before becoming Minister of Labor. Mm-hmm. And so, Michala Marksová, you're most welcome. Give us your views. Thank you.
Thank you for the introduction, dear Professor Švejnar, dear ladies, dear gentlemen. I am very happy to be here because, as Mr. Professor already said, I used to work with the studies of CERGE-EI long before. Now I must admit that I have read personally the studies and work with them before I was a minister. I'm sorry. Now I hope that my colleagues are reading it. but never mind, that's why I came, because I really knew, or I have been knowing this institution for a long time. Well, so of course it would be, in an ideal world, we as politicians would do almost all decisions based on some evidence. On some research, on some data. But of course, as we all know, it's not true, unfortunately. Because sometimes our life is really very fast and we are not managing to look at some researches. But sometimes it's a trouble with this issue which Mr. Zimmerman mentioned. And this is the public opinion and kind of public feeling, which sometimes really is completely against those issue or those data you find from your research. One for me is one example with which I really used to work a lot. We, as probably most of you know, within Europe, our women have some of the biggest troubles to be back on the labor market when they have children until the age of 12. And we know this for a long time. And we know it also thanks to the studies from OECD or from CRG. And we also know that to help to change the situation, we need two things. We need to make shorter our... I'm thinking about you here, Mr. Urida, who has been writing it personally all the time. And we need to make shorter our parental leave, which actually is up to the fourth year of the child, even. And second, we need to have these preschool institutions, which means also for children under the age of 3. And within the 2 previous conservative governments, for example, this was for me an issue when I was in opposition, and we have been discussing it a lot, because also from ideological reason to have institutional care for children under the age of 3, it's a big ideological issue in this country, because we used to have such institutions before 89, and then in the 19th, many of them were actually closed with the idea that now our women will be very happy to stay at home because they are not forced to work anymore as they were in the communist or in the socialist times. Nevertheless, we know that it would help, but also it was not only the ideology of the conservative government, but the obstacle to introduce such measures is also in the heads of the women, of our women. Because when you do then opinion researches, which I think is also important part of all this, then you discover that they themselves actually do not want to change, and they themselves want to stay at home until the age of 3 years of their children, which very often means to be at home, to stay at home for maybe 6 or 7 years when you have these 2 children, one after another. But we also know, thanks to opinion researches, that this opinion is changing slowly. So then more and more women are changing their mind, but I think it's still not enough to make, because now in my position as a minister, I would be very happy to cut the parental leave, but I can't, because although I know that based on all of your researches, it would be good, I know that I can't do it as a politician who needs to be elected again. So I'm sorry. And now we have another measure which we would like to introduce, and this is again connected to parental leave. It should be this motivation that more fathers would take at least part of the parental leave, meaning that you should take part of the leave and make it available only for the so-called second parent, meaning for fathers. But again, now, because we are already careful being at the ministry officially, so we decided again to make a research and ask people in the proper age if they would welcome such measure or not. We don't have the results yet. It will just start this research. So sometimes we would like to make or introduce measures based on this evidence-based approach, but we are not able to, unfortunately. But we have some good examples of using the data. For example, we are fighting to increase the minimum wage, and we are also always using data also from abroad that our minimum wage is very low compared to the, how we call it, average wage. So it helps us to explain the increase which this government makes and also would like to make in the future. And we also used this approach when we established two kinds of social benefits, which are called the living and substantial minimum. It means a sum of money which you need as an individual to survive, to buy basic food and some clothing and so on. And when several years ago, when this sum was established either for adults or for children, then it was also based on research on statistical data, how big costs of food and, I don't know, hygienical issues and whatever are to, so what this sum can be to keep people kind of alive as a basic, for a basic living. So we do use this until today. Also what I would like to mention, we are also collecting plenty of data through our labor offices, through our office for social security, but sometimes we are not able to use them, because what is also one of our problems is that our IT system is very old, and sometimes if I would like to get some data, which we have, some officer has to sit in front of the computer and actually collect it with pen and paper. And the most modern one is also Excel, but the person has to really do it like by hand. So this is also sometimes a small obstacle, but I hope we are on the way to have some more modern IT system. So I think that's for the introduction enough. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Minister Marksela. That was actually excellent, because you gave us both examples of how you can use and do use evidence that's generated through research, be it your own or other, but also reminded us that it is difficult for numerous reasons, the political ones that we are to some extent aware of, but then also the technical ones that you mentioned at the end. And definitely, we're very pleased that you were using the studies from CERGE-EI, and to the extent that we can continue in terms of your ministry, drawing on what we do or letting us know what could be done that would help, I think that's one of the missions of the institution. Thank you. So our next speaker is Stefano Scarpetta. I just realized, Stefano, that I was at your dissertation defense. I mean, this was actually one of the greatest challenges I had, because this was a defense in French. I was invited by in Paris. I thought I can't forego a trip to Paris. I knew Stefano, so I naturally wanted to see him again and read his book. But then I had to sweat through presenting in French. I used to know French, and so I quickly brushed up, and Stefano successfully became one of the leading economists in terms of setting policy for OECD and therefore the world. So give us your views.
Thank you very much. Actually, it was a challenge for me as well, because I discovered only very late in the process that my thesis had to be in French. It was written in English. So I had to spend 6 months in a really crash in terms of turning the thesis into French. Madam Minister, distinguished guests, colleagues, it's really a pleasure for me to be here with you to discuss about the labor economics and its public policy impact on economic growth. But let me say, not only for the reason that Ian mentioned that he was in my jury, but for many other reasons, I'm particularly pleased to be here to celebrate the prize, the IDSA prize that Ian received. I think, like many of you in this room, Ian has been for me a truly continuous source of inspiration. Let me give you two examples. I was a young economist at OECD, just arrived, and I was assigned to a group that was looking into labor market issues in the Central and Eastern European countries in transition. That was the very early 90s. And I think, as Gerard said before, there was certainly a risk to somewhat adopt policy analysis and policy recommendation of the then OECD member countries and pretend to apply this policy, this way of thinking, analysis, to the transition economies, not paying due attention to the fact that these were transition economies. There was a transition process. There was a need to adapt institutions, to build institutions, and therefore the policies had to reflect the transition process as well as the underlying transition. I think in that context, not only the papers, the many papers that Ian produced and were available at that time, but also the numerous conversations we had, I think were certainly extremely useful and beneficial for me and for many others who were working with me at OECD. The second, few years later, I was assigned to doing a project on the sources of economic growth. And I think in the team I was leading at that time, became very quickly obvious that we have to open the black box. So we had to go beyond macro data or even sectoral data and go into firm level data. And I think this has been, again, a continuous contribution of Ian, not only to promote the development of better data, but also go deeper at the micro level. And indeed, I think when we opened that box for a set of OECD countries developing comparable indicators, we discovered a fantastic world, but hugely complex world of huge heterogeneity, not only in firm characteristics, but also firm performances. So much of the policy analysis and policy recommendations we're giving, the traditional one, had to be adapted. This heterogeneity was there everywhere, whatever country you're looking at, even if at the first look, the business environment was different. There was a lot of entry, a lot of exit, a lot of heterogeneity in productivity. So the issue then became not only how to remove entry barriers, but more looking at what are the barriers to expansion of existing firms that are successful, and also how to make sure that the transmission of innovation and adoption of technology from the leading firms to the other firm. Just one example, but again, the work of Ian and also really his push to look at the micro level, I think, was certainly instrumental, very, very useful for me. This session is about the evidence-based policy analysis. And coming from the OECD, I think this is basically our bread and butter. That's what we try to do all the time. The OECD, for those who not know very well, it basically provides, facilitates a dialogue among policymakers across countries, within countries at different level of the government, and also with the main stakeholders. Which for us basically means, on the one hand, try to distill what are some of the key messages deriving from theory and from the empirical work that is done by many of you, by the academic community, as well as doing complementary work ourselves at UECD. And we know how difficult it is, for the very reason that the minister was mentioning before, to do that process, to distill what is the evidence from theory and empirical work in a way that can lead to a good, effective reflection among policymakers, most of the time pressed to intervene quickly, even when the evidence is not fully there, and also with significant policy and political constraints. So you not only have to distill the best lessons from theory and from evidence, but you have to factor in, to some extent at least, the political economy of policy making and the political economy of reforms. So that's the complex challenge on which we play a minor role, but I think an important role at OECD. Also, the evidence changes dramatically and very quickly, and the theory does not necessarily catch up with that, and to some extent, the political pressures in the governments also evolve very rapidly. So how you do reconcile all of that? Let me just give you two examples. One is about process, and the other one is about one area of policy in which I've done quite some work over the years. One is about the process. Some of you might have followed the OECD for a number of years. So you might remember back in time, 94, the OECD produced a job strategy. This was the first comprehensive strategy on labor market and social policy issues in which we provide a framework, but also a way to think through how to look at the different interaction of policies and institutions, and to look at then how to read some of the outcomes we do find in the labor market. That strategy was, I think, influential, at least internally at OECD, to guide the dialogue among the policymakers. But of course, 10 years later, we had to reassess the job strategy because there was a lot more evidence, things have changed a lot, and therefore the original job strategy was no longer a valid tool to guide the policy reflection. What we have done then? Well, first of all, we recognized that there were different models of organizing institutions and policies in the labor market, drawing from the experience of a number of rather successful countries at that time, of having a corporatist approach with strong institutions, pretty strong regulation, a lot of intervention in the labor market, both in terms of income support for the unemployed and other benefit recipients, but also very active policies to promote reintegration of people from benefit into jobs. That was a significant turning point in the way in which we're thinking about the labor market. Second, we're paying much more attention, for example, on some groups for which specific policies were needed, and the traditional overall policy were not necessarily reaching them out. I think the minister mentioned a number of interesting cases in that, at that point. That was back in 2006, so before the global financial and economic crisis. Still, maybe I can say that since I was involved into that, the job strategy was very much falling on long-term outcomes in terms of employment, unemployment in general for specific groups. We miss part of the dynamics in the labor market mobility transitions within the labor market, and that to some extent we're also missing some of the elements of the political economy of reforms, which are very important. So then the global financial crisis hit, and I think let me share with you some of the lessons we have learned. In my view, one of the lessons is that when we look at institutional policy in the labor market, yes, we have to look at how they contribute to certain outcomes that may be better or worse, but also we have to look at whether these policy institutions are also conducive to making the labor market more resilient to shocks. I think the global financial crisis was indeed a major shock that hit all our economies, and the way in which the labor market responded was not only due to the macroeconomic developments, but also because of different policies and institutions. And indeed, when we look at whether the same policy institutions we've been looking at for many years were also conducive to better, to more resilient labor market, we discovered that broadly speaking, most of them, yes, were actually good for sort of long-term outcomes as well as for promoting resilience, but there were a number of interesting cases. One for sure that this way of basically creating flexibility in the labor market at the margin by creating new typology of flexible labor market contract, temporary contract, fixed-term contract, the variety of contract exists in many of our countries, were not good for longer-term outcomes. We're not looking for making the labor market more resilient. It was pretty impressive to notice that all job losses in France and Italy were among those on temporary contracts. 85% of the job losses were among those on temporary contracts in Spain. The second, which I think is also interesting, is that collective bargaining, if properly organized, not only at the national but also at the firm level, it was a very powerful tool to allow companies to adapt not only on one margin, basically through the workforce adjustment, but also more on wages and working time. I think we all know and we praise the Kurzarbeit model in Germany, actually was there during the crisis in 22 OECD countries. What is the problem? Some of the countries introduced that scheme in different forms during the crisis. And obviously, they were much less effective than a system like the Kurzarbeit that was there, was dormant in good times, but became extremely powerful when actually was needed. But what we have seen in Europe, much more adjustment on wages and working time than what we could have expected using our models from previous crises. So there was a lot going on at the firm level in which employer workers and unions were actually negotiating not only on one margin, but actually on the other important margin. That, I think, is a lesson that I think we are bringing in into the new revision of the OECD job strategy. The other important point was the fundamental role of a good combination of income support to the unemployed with active labor market policies. Yes, many countries, since this is an automatic stabilizer, increase resources for unemployment benefit. Not many countries increase resources for active labor market policies, actually. If you look across the OECD countries, resources available on active labor market policy per unemployed decline in the order of 20, 30, 50%. So at the time when you probably need these resources the most, because you have to place back into fewer jobs, many more unemployed, resources for the public and private employment services were actually reduced significantly. Only a few countries, Denmark and Switzerland, have a system whereby also active labor market policy react almost automatically to the increase in the number of clients, potential clients, the unemployed. I think another important lesson, if we are serious about this activation strategy, mutual obligation, in which, yes, you have to provide income support to the unemployed, but you also make sure that this individual look for a job and are supported in that process, then I think a better combination of the income side, the passive, and the active, in my view, is very important. Other lessons we have learned from the crisis, which I think should receive more emphasis. Other important point, and this is something which at OECD we have done for a long time. We look at the long-run effect of structural reforms, including labor market reforms. Well, there is more and more evidence that there are distributional short-term effects of these reforms, and therefore I think it's important for the political economy, but actually to make sure that these reforms can get through, to look at these distributional effects of some labor and other reforms. And I think the evidence is building that these distributional effects, these short-term costs, tend to be concentrated on already disadvantaged group, more vulnerable groups. And therefore, having complementary policies, whether it's product market regulatory reforms, whether it's labor market reforms, in my view, it's very important. Very quickly, if I can, is on employment protection legislation, because this is an interesting area in which if you look at the past 7 years, there has been a lot of reforms in a number of European countries. And let me say that for the first time, these reforms have tackled not the marginal contracts, so the non-standard contract, but actually have touched on the regular contracts, the open-ended contracts. And I think for many years, the empirical evidence, even if theory told us that you shouldn't necessarily look at the rigidity of employment protection legislation on the level of employment of unemployment, we know that from theory, the empirical evidence was focusing on that. And maybe not surprising, the evidence was very much inconclusive. But some of the more recent work that was also driven by the fact that we finally got access to firm-level data flows shows that when you look at where potentially there is an impact, in other words, in the dynamics in the labor market, but also in the nature of this dynamic, in a sense, it's not just job creation and job destruction, but what type of jobs are created and what type of jobs are destroyed, you start seeing an effect of this regulation on the overall turnover, on the type of turnover, concentrated on temporary contracts or more on permanent contract, and I think, interesting enough, on the efficiency of the allocation of labor to most productive uses and on productivity, which brings to the point about economic growth. So for some years, the empirical evidence, because of the data availability and beyond the interesting case studies, was focusing, I would say, in the wrong spot. And as soon as the data and the analysis focus on the right spot, we start trying to make sense of the impact of that very important sort of piece of labor market legislation, labor market institution, but again, not only looking at labor market outcome, going beyond the labor market, and looking also at the more aggregate effects and the effect on resource allocation and on productivity. These are just two examples of the fundamental importance of evidence-based, but also an evidence-based that evolves in line with theory, in line with the empirical work that many of you are involved in, but also with an open mind, in the sense also be willing to reconsider some of the standard recommendations that we and others in different institutions have been providing. Thank you.
Thank you, Stefano. That was a really nice overview and in-depth point of view of how things are done on a larger than single country level. And indeed, the examples you gave, I think, are very, very telling.
So Daniel Munich, for many of you, I don't have to introduce him. The interesting thing is he is both a student from CERGE-EI and a faculty member at CERGE-EI. He, with Stepan Jurajda, I think, are the foremost labor market analysts in the Czech Republic, in the academic sector, that also go into the policy realm. And Daniel has, for the last several years, indeed driven the effort here at CERGE-EI to go from the academic research that has always been strong here to actually bringing the results of research and carrying out additional research at the level where policymakers who are educated but not necessarily specialists, economists, can actually and should use it. And so it's terrific that he's willing to share with us now some of these experiences.
Thank you, Jan. I've been asked to be in the panel in the last minute, and it's typical for my life. There were several things which changed my life unexpectedly and significantly, and there was one important driver of all that, and it was Jan. I will follow with the established practice that I will go back when I met Jan for the first time. I still remember that Henk Farber met him about 40 years ago, if I remember well. Alan Krueger's 30. I am not comparable in terms of intellectual capacity to these people, but I compare in terms of time I know Jan, and it's about 24 years. And he changed my life at least three times. All these cases were unexpected. It was ad hoc decision, and in all the cases, finally, it turned out to be a good decision. So let me go back into history a little bit. I finished university education. I got the engineer degree at the end of 90s, or in 1990, okay, in heavy current engineering. I didn't have a clue about economics. I had the just feeling that heavy industries in Czech Republic will be in some trouble during following decades. Just a feeling, you know, not being an economist. And I didn't know anything about economics. My advantages were three. I knew English somehow. It happened that I studied English. Despite that, as Professor Roland said, nobody expected the fall of the Russian Empire. Second, I knew mathematics from being engineer in heavy current engineering. It's important for modern economics. And third, I didn't know anything about central planning and this kind of economics, which is destroying humans' minds. So this was the perfect product for to apply for CERGE, in those times CERGE PhD program, which was established in 1991 or two. I'm the second cohort here. And without search, I would probably go into heavy industry and be somewhere, not being here, definitely. Okay. 2 years later, I didn't know Jan there in those times, despite that he established search, yeah, with a few other people. And then, CERGE-EI works as US department, so they hire research assistants. There was a call, so I applied for a position with Jan. And this was the first time I found that there is something like labor economics. I didn't know what it is. And then told me, look, you will do assistance for me, so you should probably take the course which is offered labor economics. So it took me several days to think about studying this strange course. I knew about macroeconomics, about finances. You know, everybody wanted to be macroeconomist and finance person to make a lot of money. So finally, I agreed, okay, I will take labor economics. I will see what it is, okay? And we started collecting data with Stepan and a few other colleagues, students, in those times at Czech labor offices in the very early 90s, traveling across the country with these discs. I don't know how they are called now. Nobody, younger generations, they do not know this. And we collected individual level data on individual histories. And at the end, there was a product, one of the most cited probably articles from, based on Czech and Slovak data from transition countries, Jan wrote. So it was the first time. The second time, our issue. And the third time, I was, my life cycle trajectory changed was when Jan established IDEA, the Institute for Democracy and Economic Analysis. It was 7 years ago. I didn't know about that much, but 2 or 3 years ago, I became the acting director. So since then, I know quite well. And all these three cases were abrupt, unexpected, and I think in all three cases, it was a good decision to follow this. So here is the bridge, the idea. so let me introduce IDEA. IDEA is an academic think tank within CERGE-EI, and we complement the work, the major work of CERGE-EI, which is basic research. So we do mostly empirical, policy-oriented research, and it is a combination. We combine three key ingredients, and that's what we think is making us different from all other think tanks. We apply rigorous scientific methods and approaches, work a lot with data, with very detailed individual level data. We focus on topics which are important to policies here and now. That's important. And the three ingredients, equally important, is that we present and disseminate the findings in a language which can be understood by wider audience, politicians, policymakers, journalists, and so on. So all these three ingredients are quite important. Without any, it wouldn't work. So what do? We highlight important issues which are important for the country in the European Union and globally. We provide important evidence-based policies. And I have to say openly that we frequently substitute for incapable government, whatever government it is. All the governments in the past had very big troubles to use evidence-based for policymaking. And we also substitute for frequently short-sighted and partial interest of pure businesses. Simply, we focus on issues which are longer-term, policy important, which are not done by the government, and there is no strong will on the side of the business to do them. So, doing this, we are supported these times a lot by the strategy of the Academy of Sciences, and I have to say that our example is ISA. It would be great. Would we become so big and so important, so influential? The scale and scope of ISA is our goal. It will take definitely some time to reach that. So I will conclude. Instead of presenting a topic, I will advertise a couple of events and studies. We are publishing studies which are publicly available for download from the website. So there is a number of new publications which appeared or will appear during next week, so let me advertise a little bit. Yesterday, there was a seminar on skill mismatches. It's a big debate between employers, educators, trade unions on what are the skills needed now, 10 and 20 years later. You can imagine what kind of debate it is. It's here, it's in the US. It's worldwide, okay? And we've supported empirical evidence based on individual level data. We have a study on work and pensionable age, very important issue in aging societies. Again, very empirical, how to make Czechs who can work, working longer and being better privately and paying more to the state budget. On December 14, we will have a presenting new study, taxation of high earnings. Taxation of high earnings is very random, chaotic during last 10 years in the Czech Republic. We presented similar study 3 years ago, and we now provide new evidence and more suggestion on what should be done to make it more standard. We have a study on prisons and prisoners. All right, really. Prisons and prisoners, we have a dynamic model which is able to predict how the capacity of prisons is filled and when the capacity will be reached so that the government has enough time to build additional prisons or to find a way on the side of policies to decrease the number of prisoners. So we have a presentation on December 1st on the scientific productivity, or no productivity, intensity of publications of Czech workplaces and Czech Republic versus some European countries. And on December 1st, we'll also have a presentation of three studies which tackled the issue Minister of Labor mentioned, the gender pay differences, the gap in labor market participation. We'll provide additional empirical evidence on all those issues which you have explained here. So we hope we will contribute to the non-ideological debate in the Czech Republic with strong empirical evidence. So that's probably everything I wanted to say, and let's see.
I'm glad I could see Daniel for the fourth time today by bringing him here without letting him know in advance. And as you can see, he can take it in stride, no problem. Hartmut Lehmann is an old friend, and we've collaborated in numerous initiatives, including actually large-scale data collection. So he will mention that and some insights. He's done some tremendous work in the countries in transition and even going further east than most of us have been working. So Hartmut, I'm really pleased that you're willing again also at the last minute to help us restructure the panel, and please give us your wisdom.
Okay, thank you, Jan. Let me make two personal remarks before I talk about evidence-based policymaking. The first one is Jan and I go back about 25 years, I think, because I was together with Sol Estrin, Jan's Mark Schaefer, and Gomułka, Stanisław Gomułka, at the London School of Economics in a new group, research group in 1990 that looked at transition in Poland. And Jan and Joe Brada and I think Olivier Blanchard even were part of a World Bank thing where we participated. The second remark, when Corrado invited me to come to this conference, I said, great, I can meet an old friend again, and I can meet other people I know very well and chat, and I don't have to do anything. I just can drink some cocktails and have a nice dinner. But this will be the first time of an IZA event where I really don't have to do anything. So, well, it didn't turn out quite that way, but that's fine. Okay, so what I would like to do actually is to talk a little bit about some stuff we did at IZA. And this also allows me to bring in people who have been very important at IZA when working on transition issues. One of the large projects that I would like to talk about is we have done work on labor market institutions in transition countries and their effect on labor market outcomes. This is a large three-year project. We spend a lot of time collecting these are aggregate data, essentially taking its inspiration from Steve Nichols' work quite a while back, which has also been pursued by the OECD lately. And of course, Blanchard and others have done lots of work on the issue of labor market institutions and labor market outcomes. It was a very difficult project because to collect data from Central Asian countries on employment protection legislation, tax wedge, active labor market policies, unemployment benefits, union bargaining, etc., was not easy. Anyhow, we basically found some interesting results that, and I must say that this relates to a period before the shock. So if you like, our results relate to normal times, if you like. So we found that employment protection legislation, the tax wedge, and active labor market policies were driving outcomes like employment, general unemployment, youth unemployment, and long-term unemployment, as well as informality, actually, whether people were working in the informal sector. maybe the most interesting result for policymakers is that there are actually complementarities when you do reforms. So interacting several reforms at the same time or launching several reforms of institution at the same time gives you more bang for the buck than just doing single reforms. A second large project is still ongoing in a sense, is informality. This is a project we did work on informality in Russia with Angelika Zaitseva, who is also here. Essentially, when governments publish data on informality, it's not clear actually how they got these data, how they got these the percentages, because we found, like others, that it depends very much on the definition and on the measurement, how large the incidence is of informal employment, and also who is affected. Finally, I still have lots of time, I guess. Let me talk a little bit about IZA world of labor, actually, and the kind of work that in the transition area has been done. Let me just talk about two papers. One which I know best, or one piece because I wrote it myself, is on costs of worker displacement in transition countries. Of course, depending on what these costs are, whether like in the US where people have found that, I guess that's probably a consensus, that you have long-term wage costs for people who are displaced, even long into new employment. Contrary to this, in transition countries, for example, the main cost is not wage penalties upon re-employment, but actually long periods of non-employment. Those people who are able to get a new job actually do not incur any wage penalties, which is connected, which has something to do maybe with the transition context, that people who lose their jobs come from relatively low-skilled, not low-skilled, but essentially jobs where maybe the technology is not the newest. So if they do find a new job, basically they end up in a job that gives you the same wage as the one where you were before. Anyway, this is clearly an important has important implications for policymakers. That when if workers basically can't find jobs rapidly, you try to help them to find jobs. So maybe active labor market policies that help in the search effort for jobs might be a good thing to think about. Then a very interesting piece is by John Earle on privatization and what is the effect of privatization for workers in terms of employment and in terms of wages. Of course, this is a very disputed issue. Privatization everywhere in the world is very unpopular, because people have this notion that it means less jobs or lower wages, more competition for jobs, and so on. And in this very nice piece, John shows that actually it very much depends on what kind of to whom the firm is privatized. So, for example, if it's to outside to outsiders, you actually get wage growth rather than wage decreases. And it's also not clear that privatization means actually less job. Of course, Jan has done a lot of work on those kinds of issues using microdata, which is also the evidence on which John Earle bases his piece. Alexander has done a, Alexander Muravyov has done a very nice piece on employment protection legislation of post-Soviet countries, where he shows sort of the lay of the land. Okay, now let me talk about one initiative that Jan and I, and also Klaus, Klaus is, was actually very important in that initiative, I would think. And of course, good evidence means good data. Okay, and so when I was a visiting professor in Kiev a long time ago, I realized they had no data, or they did have some data, but like early on in transition in Poland, for example, even though the data were owned by the statistical office, which was a state institution, the people in the statistical office thought it was their private data, and there was no need to give them to researchers. Okay, anyway, so this was exactly the case at the beginning of 2000 in Ukraine. And so I decided it would be good to mimic the Russian longitudinal monitoring survey and do a Ukrainian longitudinal monitoring survey. And so we have now four waves. However, I mean, Jan was one who contributed to this. He also, together with Kathy, John Earle, and others, basically, we all together developed basically the questionnaire, the initial questionnaires for the ULMS. So there is really a lot of sort of overlap here. Klaus contributed in questions that have to do with migration, ethnicity, and so on. However, and this is the policy connection, it's really hard to convince people to give money for data, just for data. Yeah. You know, going around with a hat is quite frustrating, actually. So there should be a plea to policymakers, actually, to finance large data sets, because they might become actually politically relevant. So for example, the ULMS, you know, again, this is a problem that I'm having now, trying to get data for 2016, where we look also at all those displaced people from the eastern Ukraine to see you know, what happens to these people. So this is clearly of policy relevance. Also, since supposedly the Ukraine government now really started, this is the first Ukraine government that really started reforms 25 years after the transition, maybe it would be a good idea to check in 2017, you know, what effects does this have? Of course, we have a panel, so we can look at whether this really makes a difference in people's lives, the reforms of the new government. But in order to do this, you need the data, and you know, they do cost something, and people always say, oh, it's a great data set, wonderful, but I'm sorry, we're not really interested in such long-term projects. So a plea to policymakers to also finance large data sets and not only short-term policy-relevant research. Thank you.
Thank you for the account and the plea. I think that's very actually important, and the statistical offices are usually on a very, very tight budget. I just happened to be at a conference in South Africa where one of these issues was discussed. There are the sustainable development goals that are now being prepared and to be implemented, and the statistical office representatives were saying, well, if we are to monitor this just to provide some evidence on how we're doing on fulfilling these, we would need budgets that are 5 to 10 times as large as the entire budgets of the statistical offices that they have. So there is just no way where any of these sustainable goals can be monitored with any degree of you know, completeness going forward. So this is really a big issue. We have a little bit of time for questions and comments, if there are any. You can address them to any of the panelists. Yes, are we there? I think there is a microphone probably that's available. Yeah.
Thank you very much. My question relates to science for policymaking. On November 10th, the European Commission appointed six scientists to form the high level of policy advisors, scientific policy advisors within the new scientific advice mechanism. Only one of those scientists is actually social scientist, sociologist. This high level of policy advisors would advise on anything concerning DNA surgeries to marine sustainability, personalized medicine, anything. And they would, you know, their task is to translate the conflicting evidence to engage in science communication, etc. And to provide some data interpretation. And in spite of the fact that there is an increasing number of subjects who provide this evidence from the EU agencies, independent, non-independent actors, including academia. And my question would be, do you think that something of this similar concept of advice mechanism with high level group of people, of scientists, basically, who would be appointed by identification committee would be possible within economic area?
Right, who would like to take that? Klaus?
I could talk about that because indirectly I was also involved in this debate since academies of sciences were invited also to make proposals. And being a member of two of those organizations, including the Academy of Science of Europe, we had debated that issue. So we are a bit concerned, even representing all sciences, yes, also in that academy, we are concerned about that the focus that the Commission is again in certain parts of the sciences, ignoring as the social sciences, largely. That's what the impression is. Now, the question is how to counteract. I don't think we have the power to establish alternatives. However, I mean, the academies, in principle, have, since the foundation of the academies, have this vision that there is the authority, and the academies should go out and fight more for what knowledge is based in these academies. Yes, that's not always easy because we have no longer a compact organization like ICA or like the European Economic Association or whatever. We have a raw collection of individuals very often, and to compromise on what we know, so to speak, and it takes years. So it's a bit of a problem. So I think the problem is there historically. I'm not sure who else is seeing it differently here, but the problem is known for long, and unfortunately we haven't made us clear enough in the current process to gain more effect on this elections. Yes, but there was a committee who was carefully selecting others. Yes, that's basically what happened.
There was like 176 organizations. They nominated the scientists, and there was an identification committee who then appointed them.
I know.
There.
Okay, please, I want to ask about inclusive growth in Czech Republic. That if Germany can accept a very large number of refugees to be included in their label. Why is it that Czech Republic has a very high thousands of people in detention camps? How can the European Union and Czech Republic absorb those people for growth in Europe? Or are they benefiting more from keeping them in detention camps than giving them freedom to work and contribute to growth in Europe? That's my question.
No. We'll have the minister address that issue. Thank you.
Okay, so first, you should know that it's not about thousands of people in our detention centers. Second, these people are in those centers for the time before they are identified Third, they do not want to stay in our country, most of them. They want to go to Germany. So far, we have about, 60 to 80, really just 1080 people who said that they would really like to stay in the Czech Republic and ask for asylum officially. And those people, of course, are going to be included in the labor market. They are going to be helped and so on. So it's not, I think you have a wrong information. And it's logical because our social system in general, for our people, for our own people, it doesn't matter if you are a refugee or not, is not at all as rich and perfect as, for example, in Germany, first. Second, the migrants, many of them have relatives in Germany, in Sweden, I don't know where, but they do not have relatives here in the Czech Republic. So the situation is as it is.
Should I also just give a slightly, but not very different view, a slightly different view? So certainly there is, it's exactly right what you're saying. People at the moment want to go to particular countries, Austria, Germany, Sweden, for whatever reasons, not only because these are rich countries. Now the question, however, is if we talk about real refugees, yes, or war, people coming from war or from asylum, need asylum, then it's about immediate help. It's about helping people who are in desperation, and we have a human obligation to do so. But not as a specific country, but as a continent, yes? That people arrive under the Dublin Agreement in Greece and Italy, and should, but in theory, all stay there, because that's what the Dublin Agreement is. But instead sent off just to the north is not a good common policy. And we see at the moment tons of pressures on Europe, but Europe, in my view, will collapse and fail in the long term if we don't take the issue of solidarity. So if some countries only receive 10 or 100 people a year, and are not willing to talk about a quota of a few thousands or so, that's a real problem. That in general one has to talk about who can carry the load, yes, and do we need a financial compensation? That's something else. But there is not in theory just one country. It's just Germany, but I'm representing Germany in a way, but I'm not talking for Germany as such. We are willing to take the largest amount of people. That's not the problem. But there has to be a general European solidarity. So at the beginning, one should not just say we never consider. Yes, also within Germany, we have certain states. We have a quota system in Germany. Immediately, everybody will be distributed. We have exactly the same debate. People say, oh, I'm brought to North Rhine-Westphalia. I jump out of the train. I run somewhere else. I disappear illegally because I want to go to Berlin. Yes, and so on. So, but this is, at the beginning, it's about immediate help. It's not about the second round or third round allocation. So I would like to advertise a little bit for a more open-minded discussion about the general burden sharing across the continent, because otherwise we will also not accept all the other challenges. Now we have a terrorist attack. This is also can only be approached with a general approach of sharing risk and activities. Now, with respect to the labor force, it's very clear that most of the refugees have absolutely no chance to find any job in the labor market for many reasons. Some of them are not even recognized, have to return. Others do not want to stay in the long term. They just want intermediate help. If the problems are solved somewhere, they want to go back home. And so on. So the problem is very much complex, and most of the people who arrive at the moment are less qualified than the typical migrants Europe has. For instance, in the past years, last past decade or so, Germany received much better qualified at the upper end migrants than even in the German population. But the people we now get are much less qualified. And there's a midterm, long-term even. So we count that maybe only 50% of those who arrive, even when we help, have within 5 years a job, if they are qualified at all, potentially, out of the million, perhaps only 200,000, if you give you just a number, and the others takes much longer. So there is not, I mean, there is a broad willingness across Europe to talk about these issues and to have a long-term strategy. And the continent needs people, certainly, yes, and it needs a flexible reaction to the situation. But this, I mean, in this sense, I'm completely on your side. Yes, we have to consider that, but it's not just an issue of one country, it's an issue of the continent. I would like to make this point. Okay.
Thank you. So we had another hand over there.
My name is Philip Pertolt. I'm from Think Tank Idea here. My question is to the panelists rather, okay, so how do we want to persuade politicians to look at evidence? But the question for me is rather how to persuade them to look at the right evidence, in a sense, how they interpret the data correctly and the statistics. For me, the nice example was that if the Ministry of Social Affairs is asking women whether they want to collect benefits, and they say yes, and this is the argument for us to keep the social policy, it's not the right evidence for me, or it's not the evidence how I see it, how to end the debate. So my question is to you, how to persuade politicians to look at the evidence rightly or correctly? Thank you.
Well, that's a very easy question. First of all, we have to agree on what is the right evidence in the first place, right? Because you might think you have the right evidence, but maybe others, even in this room, might not think that you have the right evidence. Their evidence is the right one. So in the sense that there is a lot of work that this community, the academic community, has to do in order to distill what seems to be not the consensual, but at least the sort of, you know, one possible way to interpret very complex facts that I think characterize the labor market or any social outcomes that we find in our economies. Second, I think, and this is what we try to do as much as we can at the OECD, you have to distill this evidence in a way that can be understood and brought into a policy, a political process within a government or within whatever public institution that has to make political decisions and policy decisions, which is not easy because I think, and I count the OECD among the others, sometimes the way in which we basically present our evidence-based policy analysis is not easy to interpret or to convert into policy making. So I think there is a big agenda there. Just to give you one example, what we are doing in my department over the past 5 years is to whatever we have a major flagship publication. Unfortunately, our flagship publication tend to be that thick. I mean, 200 pages is the absolute minimum, and nobody reads. No meaning. She also came from research, but no minister reads that. So it's to distill a very short document out of this thick publication in a way that can, first of all, influence a public debate beyond ministers and beyond government, because that's what you need. And then also possibly policymakers. That's extremely difficult because when you turn from 200 to 5 pages, you really have to make sure that you have grasped these 200 pages and there is consistency within that. So I think that's an important point. The right evidence is only when there seems to be consensus, at least a convergence of views of many different studies that point in a given direction. I think in our field, the one of liberal economics, that's not obviously the case in many, many areas. So there is a lot of work which is needed, which I think has to draw from the best data. The call that Artem was making about trying to make sure that we have the evidence, the data there, in order to produce the best possible evidence-based policy analysis, I think is the first point. But second, I think there is a sort of a challenge, but also an obligation on the side of the academic community, an institution like mine, to make sure to distill the best evidence, but also turn into something that can be then brought to the table of a government and maybe lead to a policy discussion and policy decisions. Third, I think, which is very important, is not only pretend to distill the best policy in that particular area without taking into account what Artmo was referring to, the complementarity of policy in different areas, and to some extent also the political economy. No government, even the one with the largest majority, can possibly implement the best policy in each and every area without thinking about where to put the political capital they have, and also without thinking about possible complementarities of action in different areas. And third, in my view, fundamental, not be satisfied about producing good recommendation policy, but actually follow whatever policy are then put in place by the country. So basically, assess and reassess your own recommendation on the basis of evidence about what actually is happening on the ground once some of the policy recommendations have been implemented by the countries.
Thank you, Stefano. We'll have Minister Mark Sowa give us still a set of remarks. Thank you.
So first, I just would like to ask you, we can discuss it drinking wine, what is the opinion of people if you do a real proper research? Is it like, do you count it as evidence or not? I don't know. It's up to you to answer. I have been honest to tell you that we are, as politicians, in trouble. Here we have some research, okay, which is nice, and on the other hand, we may have the opinion, not of big public, but also of our voters. And don't forget that what is today being done by the political parties is that we take groups of our voters and we ask them, and like it or not, but it is important for the party to get this opinion. And then, of course, the policy you produce is also based on these results. I'm not saying that it's nice and it's good, but it is as it is. And I can't imagine a political party which would totally ignore what its voters think and will just do some policy which do maybe people in the top of the party would honestly think it's good. Yeah, but that would be end of this party. I'm sorry.
Klaus, you had a quick remark, thank you.
Yeah, this has to do with this debate. I think we should not ask the politicians for the impossible. Yes, that's exactly the point. Politicians have to be elected and they have to be re-elected. And of course, since election is a short-term aspect, there's sometimes this problem what is right in the short run can be completely wrong in the long run. But it's also clear that something what is, when you, as policymaker, you can act against reality, yes, for a while. If voters want it, you can do it for a while. And you have also right to do so, even to do mistakes as a policymaker. However, in the long term, of course, the country runs in a disaster. So when there are facts, then after, in the long term, yes, at the moment we are ruining, Germany has saved the pension system in the Hartz reforms. At the moment we are ruining the pension system again with a few measures. Don't want to detail it. We can do it. We have lots of money now. The government thought we have 80% of the voters. We do this. We have all support. Nobody was objecting. We all know that in 5 years all this will be washed away. Okay, this is possible. In the long term, however, there are some things you cannot avoid. We as scientists have to make clear that this is something we have to bring up and again. So I agree. So sometimes evidence, relevant policies are there, or they're not. Sometimes not relevant, evidence relevant policies. So for instance, in Germany we had the minimum wage debate. Yes, but the minimum wage debate was, we have a minimum wage now, very high. But the point is, people wanted that. Yes, it's not that it helps the poor, it doesn't help the poor. It doesn't create unemployment, no, it maybe a bit or whatever, perhaps in the long run, we don't know. No, nobody cares really about all these things. But everybody feels better because we have it. Since, okay, if a society is rich, we can afford these kind of mistakes. And we should not ask policymakers all the time to only follow what is evidence-based. Yes, so this would be unrealistic. However, what we could insist on, that we establish more and more things in the system which make sure that long-term thinking is enforced on the political process. Like if there's a new measure, it has to be evaluated after a few years. So program evaluation is a very important issue. The provision of data, yes. I often was also get phone calls of a minister. Can you tell me what this number is? And I say, first, well, if this number is available, I first have to ask the statistical office to get access to the data, and maybe in half a year I have this access, and then I can look at it, and then I answer your question. Or we have to make a survey, come back in 5 years or something. This is impossible, but this is reality. Now, however, what we have to do is, yes, for instance, has this country, well, we, Hartmut has mentioned the Ukrainian panel data set. Yes, in Germany, most of the policy debates nowadays in the context of labor are based on the German socioeconomic panel, which is now in the 30th wave. There we have tons of data, which is examined by not only one research team, by many research teams for free at the universities who study the questions. So what we have to do is, if you want to have evidence-based policy making, you have to establish infrastructure for where you can draw on. So if you don't have a unique panel data, so you certainly should fight for to have that. Or a statistical office. You mentioned that, or somebody mentioned here that people at the statistical offices think sometimes that's their data. That was also true in Germany. But we have now methods or mechanisms where everybody, researchers, can access the data at the offices. And then if you have that, then you have a much better potential. If the minister wants to know something, you can say, oh, I have this. I have a right to look at this, and I answer the question within a week. So that's where we have to, I think, where we have to go if you want to get progress.
All right, we'll have one concluding comment from Daniel Munich, and then indeed we will continue over wine. So.
Thank you. I will follow up on what was said here. I will put it more to the local Czech perspective. I am convinced, strongly convinced, that evidence-based policy making has huge potential in almost all member states across the European Union. And if situation is difficult and problematic in Germany, it's many times more problematic in the Czech Republic. It's my opinion, based on sitting on many advisory committees for the government, that the major obstacle of long-term growth and growth in living standards is the poor performance of public governance in general terms, and part of it is missing evidence-based policymaking. So there are three things to put together. The data, which were heavily debated here. Czechs have plenty of data at the Ministry of Labor, Social Security, Records, Statistical Office, but there is access is impossible. Okay. Of course, you would like to get more data, which do not exist, but you'd be happy having access, research, scientific access to data which already exist, which are collected for a lot of money, public money. Second, you need human resources and good quality social sciences. I could have a presentation on the poor quality of social sciences in all post-communist countries. It's another big setback. We do not compare Germany. Germany is much more advanced in that. I mean, they are performing much better. And the third is that you have to have a demand for evidence-based policies. And the demand should come from policymakers, from politicians, these are very close to each other, and from voters. Definitely from voters, and how, in fact, it starts with the voters, finally. So how to make voters demanding more evidence and so on? You have to explain to them that it's important and that what's politically presented as good should be subject to very detailed exploration, scientific or policy-oriented research. So, and that's what we are trying to do in IDEA. Thanks.
All right.